Okay, so I know talks in the afternoon are a little difficult, so let's do something fun, okay? I want all of you to stand up. Just kidding. How many of you think it's annoying, you know, when you attend these workshops and the facilitator comes in after lunch and says, makes you stand up and do these really silly and annoying things? Yeah? Yay. Don't worry, I'm not going to let you guys do that. So, yeah, we're talking about Angular 2 and how to make it lean and fast. Some of the topics that we're covering, probably just one is actually specific to Angular. The rest of them are universal and general, and you can apply them to any framework or any application that you're building. And no, you do not need to know Angular 1 or Angular 2 or anything else to follow the talk. All you need to do is just remember a couple of those keywords or jargon I'm going to throw around, and you can Google your way through and find a way out. Yeah. So Angular 2 was released yesterday. Yay. Finally, right? Great, great. And I'm not going to beat around the bush. I'm here to garner some love for Angular. So obviously, I think we all know that Angular hasn't seen the best of times off late, and things haven't been very good. But now that Angular is finally released, let's put all of that aside and just try and enjoy the amount of great work that the code team has put in. So I'm really hoping that after this, you know, people kind of get interested in Angular, a lot of people start exploring it, playing around with it, and maybe some of you also start falling in love with it. Right? Yeah. So what happened was, after my last talk at Meta Refresh, I finished my talk and I was just walking around. One of my colleagues walked in and he said, hey, great talk, but you know, others were a lot more entertaining. So I'm trying to make my talk a little entertaining this time. And that explains that GIF out here, and probably a few more that you're going to see. OK, so first, when you talk about Angular, the first thing that pops up, oh my god, you changed so much. I don't even recognize you, right? Yeah. So there's a reason to that. Back in the days when you made single page applications and when Angular was primarily used to do those things, life was very easy. The expectation of a SPA was very, very basic. Get the data from the server, render it, give me a client side experience. I'm happy with that. And I'm okay to wait a few additional seconds here and there, but I just want to enjoy that client side experience. So that was what SPAs were meant to do. But since then, things have changed a lot, right? Concepts have changed. So one of the things that Angular really sold on was this thing called data, two-way data binding, right? Angular did this two-way data binding. Everybody's excited about it. A lot of other frameworks did that. But as you moved along, people figured out, okay, that's probably not the right way to do it. And a lot of concepts came in. Paradigms changed. Toolings changed. So there was a time when these were the standard tools that we would work on. Most of us would use the same tools. But now that's drastically changed. A whole bunch of tools have come into place, a lot of libraries, a lot of frameworks in. And not only that, you have multiple options that do the same job for you, right? And what's also changed is this. The attention span of the average human has dropped below that of a goldfish. So what that means now is an average attention span, and this study was done in 2013, when it says a human being can stay focused for about 8 seconds. It's about 3 years now, so probably that number has dropped. And what that means for us is, no, it's not that we have got 8 seconds or what 5 seconds for us to load up our application. What it actually means is that within that 5 seconds or 8 seconds, you need to get your application loaded, let the user click around, interact with your app, and kind of read up the content and get interested in your app so that he or she's committing to spend the rest of the time on the app, right? So that's the amount of time that is there. And that really requires us to rethink the way things had been done before. And the entire focus is now is on performance and speed, right? And obviously, what the Angular team realized at that point of time was taking into account the new landscape, that is, the new tools that are available, and keeping speed and performance, the best way to do it is write the library from the ground up, right? And just try and imagine that for a library that has been so popular, which is so been used across so many places, for somebody to come on there and say, hey, we're going to write this from scratch, requires a lot of courage. And I think we should try and appreciate that. So that's great. The next question, now what's taking so long? It's been 2 years, guys. So what's taking so long? So for this, I have a nice, small, funny clip, actually, from a talk by Shai Raznak. He gave this talk in ngConf for 2016. So he's trying to predict when Angular 2 is going to be released, and also try and dwell upon why it's taking so long. So just have a look.
Uh, So even he couldn't predict the future or when is the release date. So we were left with only one choice, to try and figure out when it will get released ourselves. Try to assess the number of features and by that, the year of the release. So let's go back to 2014, to Angular2 App, when they first announced the development of Angular2.
What are these new ingredients in Angular2? We're going to talk about mobile, we'll talk about performance, and scale.
Okay, let's see. So we have we're talking about mobile, okay? So and we're talking about performance, and it should be like scale, okay? So we're talking about like, I don't know, 1 year of development, and it should be done by 2015 probably, right? But then came 2015.
There's a couple things that we think we can do to actually push our abilities even further.
Uh-oh.
Let's talk about server side.
Wait, what?
So we have done a lot of things in Angular2 to make it possible to run things on a server.
This is a much more generic framework.
It is very high priority for us to have lazy loading.
It's an internationalization.
There's still a lot of stuff we need to do
with regards to the payload size.
Since ngconf, we actually didn't know that we were going to do this. It's kind of exciting when fun things like that happen.
Yeah, exciting. Or shall I say, panic. Yeah, so guys, just release the framework already, okay? Enough with the feature. Look at all this feature, okay? We were talking about like another year of development, and we just want to just release the framework and leave it with these features, okay? And then add more afterwards. So we'll be done by 2016, and that's it, okay? Okay. Okay.
Is that we're building a command line interface.
Angular CLI.
Material design with component router.
Observables.
You can do functional reactive programming.
Could we move the framework itself into the web worker?
Finding an XML template with data to create a native UI component view.
So yeah, so that was it. So I'm sure a lot of you guys are thinking, you know, that's the fundamental problem with Angular. They're trying to do too many things at the same time. You should not do that. You should probably just focus on that one single thing and do it right. A lot of other libraries are doing that, right? A lot of people are doing that. And at some point of time, even I thought that's probably the way to go. But if you look at it, our job as engineers, we need to build end-to-end solutions for our customers and clients, right? And the way we do that nowadays is we pick up these libraries that do that one single great thing, put them all together and build an entire solution. Most of the time that works. Many a times, it probably does not work. It starts off great, but then as you go somewhere midway or towards the end, you start seeing a bit of a friction between these libraries and you start seeing things fall apart. And that's where Angular is trying to differentiate itself. Angular is trying to make your life easy as a developer. It's trying to give you a whole bunch of tools, libraries, and an entire platform where you can build end-to-end solutions for your clients. And that's essentially what this is. So your Angular2 platform has kind of evolved from a framework to a platform. And the way it works is like this. So you got Angular2, you got solutions for mobile, you got server-side rendering, you got components that can use material design, and you got a whole bunch of productivity tools on top of it. You have something called the Angular CLI, a command line interface that just simplifies your workflows, your development workflows. You got very tight integrations with IDE and TypeScript. Yeah, so a point on that, right? A lot of people are very hesitant to get onto Angular because, oh, it's built on TypeScript. I don't want to learn another programming language. So for one, Angular is not, you don't need to know TypeScript to write Angular code. You can write Angular in JavaScript. But the point aside, get over your stubbornness and move on to TypeScript. It's a beautiful thing. End of the day, it is not a new language. It is just ES2015 with a couple of few additional features that are there. But the productivity that you'd get as an individual and as a team is significant. So just get on to TypeScript and you really start seeing the benefits of that. And there are a couple of other things like Audrey, which allow you to do debugging of your Angular apps and stuff. So having said that, is Angular 2 really fast? So a couple of numbers from the Angular team. So Angular 2 says that the Angular beta was about 2.5 times faster than the Angular 1 and about 4.2 times faster on reloads. But by the time it reached final state, it's 5 times faster than Angular 1. So that's really fast. And how are they trying to do that? A couple of things. So the first thing is change detection. So if you remember in Angular 1, the change detection used to be more of a cyclic in nature, you know, where your parent updates a child, the child goes back and updates a parent, the child can update something else, one derivative can update something. And so the change detector kind of go into a cycle. But now with Angular 2, it's a tree. So change detection just flows all the way down, and it's very fast. Second thing, default lazy loading of your routes. So this is something that is very, very newly come in. It used to be as an optional feature till about a few releases back. But now what Angular 2 does is it looks through your routes, and looking at a route, it just lazily loads the components that are immediately required. So that significantly improves your first-time bytes. And finally, AOT. You're probably going to hear this term a lot often if you're going to be interacting with Angular. AOT stands for ahead-of-time compilation. And what it does is it takes your Angular code, converts it into VM-friendly code, and helps you reduce the bundle size and even load things faster. You're going to spend a bit of time looking at this later. And we also have something called a tree shake, which we'll just look at. So we were quite excited about all these new things that Angular is coming out, right? And we want to see how you can play with that. So me and a bunch of guys together started off trying to build up an app called the My India Report Card. So what the My India Report Card does is it goes and hits the Indian government's open data website, data.gov.in, and pulls up a bunch of APIs. So we've got APIs with regard to the attendance of our parliamentarians, the quality of the water, number of accidents in cities and stuff like that. We try and build a dashboard out of it. So let me quickly show you what we have so far. It's still a work in progress. Oh. Okay, sorry, I'm just going to need to switch to mirroring again. Refresh this. So this is the My India app. It's built on Angular CLI, uses Webpack for bundling, and uses backend web services from, like I said, from the Indian government website. And this is data of the attendance of our parliamentarians for the Lok Sabha 15 session. Interesting, you can do fun stuff. So you see a lot of people, you barely have a lot of guys who got 100% attendance, which is good. But you also have some interesting names at the bottom who have zero attendance. Do you see any names around? Yeah, any prominent names that you can come across? Yeah, there's one. Not going to name that. So that's the data of the parliamentarians. Crimes in states. So this is a graph that generates data of the number of accidents. So these are all data that the Indian government is collecting in the background and makes it available to us as open APIs. So that's the number of crimes in cities. Crime against women, actually. And you kind of realize that Uttar Pradesh, Mark takes the lead out there. And the age group of people between 18 to 30 is like the highest out there. And then you have other states falling behind. And what's interesting is like something like a state like Maharashtra, you have male above 60 years, I guess, 60 years with significant crime rates. So that's something that really should worry. Accidents in cities. So the number of accidents that are happening around. Obviously, I think Delhi takes the lead out there. And then you have Chennai coming in second. But the good thing that you notice is the number of accidents or the fatalities is that's dropping drastically. So things are improving for India. We also had actually another card that says the number of fatal accidents with regard to the type of vehicle. So that again, motorcycles had the maximum number of fatalities. But we also had two interesting cases where there were two accidents by animal-drawn carts. So there were two fatalities by animal-drawn carts. That's another thing. And finally, some data on rivers. So that's the water quality of the Ganga, measured across different data points. We were hoping to put this into a line graph. We'll probably do that. But it checks the temperature, the maximum temperature, the minimum temperature, the pH values across the various points. So there's a lot of data out there. There's some very interesting data sources that are available out there. If you're interested in data sciences, do check it out and play with that. So anyway, that's the app that we have been working with. And getting back to what we were doing, so the first bundles that we did out, that's the number that came out with. So it was about 2.9 MB. and the paints were about 4.5 seconds. So this is throttled. So this is not a full Wi-Fi thing. It's a throttled, I believe it's throttled about 1 Mbps or 3G. I'm not really sure. But that's a throttled connection that's there. So the first time we built an app in Angular 2, these are the numbers that we came in. And then we went about trying to see how we can improve the performance of that. So the first thing that you would do with an Angular app, and the latest thing that is called the ahead of time compilation, or the AOT, right? This has been the most crucial feature of Angular 2. It has been in the works for a very, very long time, and I also think it's probably one of the most complex pieces that, you know, it has taken time for them to crack. But now that it's done, it's a really awesome thing. And what exactly is AOT? Currently, most of the apps that we build, Angular, Angular 1, or even Angular 2 apps, by default, what they do is they do something called a just-in-time compilation, or a JIT that we call as. And the way it works is, so you have obviously two modes, right? You do a development, and then you deploy your app. So you deploy, you write the code in TypeScript, you would compile it using the TypeScript compiler, and then you'd bundle it, minify it, and then you deploy it onto the server. And then the end user, he or she would consume that app, the bundles would download, your Angular would bootstrap, the compiler would run, and then you would render the app, right? So that's how it works. And most of the techniques that people have been doing to try and improve performance has been trying to see how much we can reduce time in any of these steps. So can I reduce the type of bootstrapping? Can I reduce the time for the compilation and stuff like that? All that's fine, but they're all giving you very incremental benefits. The Angular team thought of doing something different. They said, why don't we just move that entire compiling thing from the render time onto the development time? And that's how the AOT came into picture. So the ahead of time compilation, the compilation actually happens at the time of development. So in this mode, you do your development in TypeScript, you run the NGC compiler to compile your application. And what the NGC does is, it takes your Angular templates, takes your HTML, your CSS, and bundles them all into a TypeScript file, which eventually gets converted into a VM-friendly JavaScript code, which you then minify and bundle and send it to your clients. And when the users download the app, you'll realize an entire step has gone missing for them. They download the app, Angular bootstraps, and starts running right away. So there's no compilation. So that's a significant benefit that you're all able to get now thanks to the AOT. A couple of things that AOT does in the background is, so when you have a components file, I'm sure everybody knows by now that Angular 2 is a string of components, right? Everything is a component. So you take a component file, and when you run in GC compiler, it converts into two files. So you have something called the NG factory, which is the compilation of the Angular component, the HTML, the CSS, all of them bundled together as a TypeScript file. And you also have the component.metadata.json, which is information that Angular needs for the bootstrapping part. This is how the files will look like. You just need to worry about the top left one because that's the code that you write. The stuff that you have below, the NG factory and the metadata files, they're all automatically generated by the compilers. You can just look at that. So I think it's somewhere like you write 20 lines of code and the compiler runs about 110 lines of code for you. The way you bootstrap is also a little different. So when you do a just-in-time compile, you would bootstrap using the bundle which says platform browser dynamic because that has the bundler along with that. But when you do an ahead-of-time compiler, you use a different bundle and it just says platform browser. So the entire compiler module is moved out of that. And what I've heard is the compiler, the code to compile it in real time was close to about 50% of the entire bundle size. So that's the reason you get the majority of the benefits. So when we did the couple of AOTs, so these are the numbers that we got at. So we moved the bundle size down from about 2.9 MB, it came down to about 1.5 MB, about 54% reduction in the bundle size. And in terms of first paints, we got an improvement of about 67%. So it was taking us about 4 seconds or 4.5 seconds, we brought it down to about 1.5 seconds. So that's a significant improvement, and I think we're pretty happy with that. Once you've done your AOT, the next step that you'd usually want to do is something called a tree shake, right? And now Angular recommends two bundles that you can work with. One is called Rollup, and there have also been experiments where you could do it using the Google Closure Compiler. And we were actually struggling to get this working. It didn't quite work for us. But then there were some other experts that got it done. And they said that they were able to get bundle sizes down to about 2.5 times of what the original was. And I was just sitting out here, and one of my colleagues, Vishwa, was probably sitting somewhere out here. He just came in and there he sits. So he just came in and said he managed to get that whole tree shake working and got it gzipped, and this is what we managed to do. I'm going to go and verify that, by the way, but this is what happened. So our bundle size moved from about 2.9 MB to about 261K. Put all of them together. So that's what you can do with AOTs and your tree shakes and gzip. So that's AOT for you, right? And universal rendering. There have been enough talks about universal rendering. I'm not going to touch upon the need to do it and why you should do that. I'm going to talk about how Angular is helping you out with that angle. So universal rendering is obviously about rendering the file on the server and transferring the state onto the client side. In Angular, you do that using your Angular Universal, which is primarily a node-based application. You can do that using nodes. You run your servers on the node. But you can also do that in ASP.NET. And there have been talks about doing it in other frameworks like Java. And in fact, we are part of some engagements with Drupal where we're trying to run Angular within the Drupal Twig templates. So the way universal rendering would work is you have your application layer in which your application runs, and you have the rendering layer. And now since Angular 2 is decoupled, you can render it specifically to whatever area that you want to run it on. So you could run rendering on the node DOM server, which runs it on the node server. You can run it on the DOM renderer, which will run it for your browser. And you also have an option of running it on things like the web worker or TypeScript and stuff like that. So that opens up a whole area of opportunity for you all. Anybody heard of the uncanny valley? Or the gap in server rendering? Yeah, there you go. So this was a tweet which Paul Lewis tweeted a couple of months back. He said the problem with server-side rendered apps or hydrated apps or whatever term that you call them as is this thing called the uncanny valley. The uncanny valley is where in your server-side app, your first view is rendered from the server. It comes in. So people are able to see that. But a client-side application hasn't loaded in. So when I try to click around or do something, I'm lost. So that's the uncanny valley that he was referring to. And he was saying frameworks should try and solve that particular problem. He had a different approach to that. And Angular Universal has a slightly different approach to that. They do something called the preboot. So what is preboot? So preboot is a small JavaScript library. It kind of injects itself into the head of the server-side HTML file. And what it does is once your server-side HTML has loaded in, it takes over. It starts recording all the actions that you have been doing. And then when the client side loads in, it goes and plays them back for you. And that's the technique that it's trying to use to solve the problem of the uncanny valley. I have an example of this. Let me see if I can show that to you. Okay, that's it. Small. Start off my webpack. Wait for it to load. So this is an example from a demo from what Patrick Stapleton showed up in ng-con. So Patrick Stapleton is one of the core contributors to the Angular Universal app. He's a maintainer for the app. Okay. So a small, simple example. Did I miss something? Oh, okay. One second, sorry. I'm just going to try and... No luck. It should work. Just going to try and close it and start it again, sorry. I'm going to give it one last try, and if not, I'm going to move forward and try and see if I can get back to this later. Or did I mess around with my code? Yeah, there you go. So you'll just see that switching between server-side to client-side. So that's a 4-second timeout that I've set in for the preboot to for the Angular Bootstrap client-side to kick in. Right? So if you refresh the page, it loads the server side. And then after, once the client side loads in, it loads the client side, and that's what you see that. So what is this uncanny valley? The uncanny valley is when I start and I type something into the text box, and once the client side takes over, it's all gone, right? So the user's like lost, what happened, stuff like that. So that's where preboot comes in, and the way preboot would work is, it's a small flag that I would set in my server-side rendered code. It's set to false right now, I'm just gonna set it to true. And then restart my server. Are we there yet? Okay, so let's try now. Refresh, server side, I type something, wait for the client side to take over, hopefully it still stays. It still stays, and I've just relayed out the message from the bundle that's recording all the actions. So the bundle has recorded all my keys presses, and it just relays out. So that's how preboot is trying to help solve the problem of the uncanny valley. And I think that's something good about Angular Universal. Okay. So that was the uncanny valley. That's a site that you can go and learn more about the universal application. As I have access to GitHub, you can play with that. Next topic, web workers. So I think everybody knows web workers are this really cool thing, and they do a fantastic job with our stuff. But the challenge has always been it's not very easy to work with. And I think it's true, to be honest, also with Angular. But the Angular team is trying to think about some pretty ambitious goals of trying to run the entire Angular code in a web worker and then just render the front-end UIs on the front-end. So these are a couple of still experimental level thoughts that are being pushed around, but this is where you're probably going to look at, see how you can run Angular 2 in a web worker. You'd have, so essentially it's divided into two parts, right? You have the browser thread or the main thread, and you have a service worker thread that's running separately. So you have an Angular application, and the, you know, the view part or the front-end part of it more rendered on the browser, and the Angular, the CPU intensive part of that, that's all running on the Angular, the web worker thread. And you're using something called the client message broker to do the communication between both of them. Because web workers cannot directly talk to the DOM, you'd use something like a message broker to start a relay events back and forth. So that's an example from there. And I have a demo of trying to show you why web workers should be, why they are so important, or why it matters. Again, we'll need to run a couple of servers. Just give me a minute, please. So we've got two Angular apps. There's a fair bit of static content, and then there's a sort of Angular code that is trying to find the largest prime number from a given set of data sets. And that's what will actually drive your CPU a little crazy. So this is the application in a single thread mode, the regular Angular app that I would say. I'll try and refresh that. And you see my page kind of like stuck and didn't move until, I'm actually trying to scroll and nothing is happening. You can see that spin happening. Then once my data loads in, then it kind of comes into life, right? So that's how Angular would run in a single-threaded mode. But if I were able to do that in a web worker, this is how it works. So I'm able to scroll very freely. My data hasn't loaded in, I'm able to scroll very freely. And now my data loads in, see? And you can see the scroll bar shooting up, and then my data has loaded in. So because web worker moves the entire intensive process into a separate thread, the UI is not hindered. And this, I think, becomes very important when you're building progressive web apps or mobile-first applications. So that's web workers for you. Service workers. the new kid on the block, right? A lot of cool things happening about service workers and progressive web apps. Yes, they are really great, and they're also important. So again, I think there's a tweet, or it's one of the points from Jake Archibald's talk. So where Jake says that it's a lot more expensive to transmit a data than to compute it on the local end. It's expensive, especially on mobile devices, on cellular networks, where the data, the route that it takes to send the data and back and forth is insane. And that's why we need to use service workers to try and see how much we can minimize the round trips or these calls to the server. And progressive web apps are essentially a kind of collection of principles, I could say. So a progressive web is one that is using an app shell model that kind of renders instantaneously, that has offline support and can run at 60 frames per second, and can also have the ability to add it to home screen. And how does Angular play in line with this? So in Angular, the root component can be treated as your app shell. So items that are part of your app shell could be the navigation bar, could be your logo, could be a menu bar, put them all into the app shell. And whenever you want to do an instant load for it, do a server-side rendering for the app shell. So always make sure your app shell is server-side rendered, because it loads instantaneously and there's no Angular bootstrapping happening at that point of time. For offline support, you obviously need to add a service worker. Like I said, the CLI is a really powerful tool. So when you're building applications and you pass a mobile flag to it, Angular CLI will automatically create a service worker for you. You want to do 60 frames per second, like an example you just showed, try and use web workers. And also for the home screen, use the Angular CLI. So when you use an Angular CLI, pass the mobile flag, it creates your home screen. It creates a web manifest file, which has those files, all the details that you need to store it as a, add to home screen icon and run it in full screen mode and all of that. And the service workers also come as a part of the Angular CLIs. So these are the things how Angular would kind of fall one-on-one when you want to build a web worker or a progressive web app. Again, some numbers of how we could have improved the performance on the mobile. It's again from one of the Angular's mobile team. So when they did their application, the first initial thing was about 2,300 milliseconds. And then when they did an app shell, it came down to about 287 milliseconds. And when you move to a service worker, it actually dropped down to about 1.128 milliseconds. So now, by using all of these things together, they're able to get these sub-second loads, which is like the holy grail for our applications, right? And you can learn more about this on the mobile Angular website, mobile.angular.io. So quickly summarizing, right? All the topics that we talked about, I would look at them as a pyramid of performance enhancements. The AOT and the tree shake is something that you should do for pretty much all the apps, because it's a given, right? It's no-brainer. You should do AOT as much as possible. When you're doing universal, obviously, yes, you should do it for as much of apps as possible, but they become predominantly important when you're doing things like e-commerce sites, or where the number of first-time visitors are a lot higher, or people are sharing it on social media, and you need to preview that image and those kind of things. So universal becomes a lot more important to that. Web workers, you're doing number crunching, you're doing data visualization, you're kind of building these big, huge dashboards. Try and do web workers over there. And the PWA sits on top of all of them. So mobile first. You're trying to build a very strongly mobile first app, or you're trying to build an app that's going to probably replace a native app, you should go for that, and then you should probably obviously go down the entire tree. So those were a couple of enhancements. And yes, a shout out to my crew. So obviously, when I came up with this whole fancy idea of building the report card and all of those things, we were like very close to JSConf, and I didn't have time to work. So I just shot out an email saying, hey guys, can somebody help me out? And these bunch of guys helped me out. So we had Akash and Keshav and Siddharth and Vishwas. So Vishwas is the guy who's sitting out there. So these guys kind of volunteered and helped me out. And the interesting thing is none of us knew Angular 2. It's all a first-time app that we built. And barely in about a 2 weeks' time, but I think the amount of time that we spent was barely a few hours. And if anybody of you guys have been playing the JS jargon game, whatever, playing, enjoying, whatever, so these are the guys who built that. It was built in the last 2 days, so it's sort of a progressive web app. I'm saying sort of because I don't think the service worker is still working very well, though. So Nishid, Shafiq, Anoop, and Bhumika, they're all part of the team that built these. So a big shout-out to these guys. Cool, okay. Yeah, I have time, that's great. So, some public service announcements. I think we as a community, in our need for being opinionated and kind of having cult status kind of to the frameworks and libraries that we use, we've sort of become cynical and have kind of created this whole environment which is intimidating to people outside. It's intimidating to people outside who want to try and enter a space from other backgrounds, or even for new people who want to enter this. I think it's very important for us to be nice. The more you become an expert, the more nicer you are supposed to become to people. Help them. Whatever question they ask, they are genuine. So please try and respond to them. And embrace diversity. So embracing diversity, obviously, in terms of gender, color, race, is a given. I think there's no two ways about it. You have to take care of that. But also within the frameworks, within the various frameworks that are available in the JavaScript community, within the various thought processes that we have, within you know the various opinions that we have. We got classes right now. People are saying, no, classes are not good. Let's do pure functions. Or we have inheritances, and no, we should do interfaces. People are not going to agree on a certain thing, right? Typing. Is typing important or not? That's another debate of its own. So people are not going to agree on a certain thing. I think what's important is embrace their diversity, respect their thoughts, but obviously also look at what are the good things that you guys are doing there and try and pick it up in your work. So with that, I'm truly done. Promise.
Questions?
Hi.
Yeah.
Nice talk, and the first talk from
Pathfinder
about Angular or something other than React.
I know.
So, yeah, thank you. And this is one question which is not technical, and I always wanted to ask people who work on Angular, why is Google doing Angular? I mean, because when I search websites which are built on Angular, none of the websites of Google are built on Angular today.
I don't think that's true.
Which one?
So DoubleClick happens to be one of the biggest clients for Angular, and there are a lot of internal applications that are built on Angular.
Yeah, internal, right?
Yeah, like, yeah, I agree.
You are getting my point. React
I get
is
your
Facebook,
point.
But Angular is nowhere on Google. So.
Yeah.
So why is Google doing Angular? What's the motive behind it?
So Google is not... So Angular is an open source framework. It is truly driven by the open source principles. If you looked at the way it was built, all the design documents were on open source. They were on Google Docs. People would look at it, comment on it, and people would... So it was a community-built framework. Google obviously is supporting it, is driving it. So it is not... I would not say it is... Why is Google not being a part of that? So it is a community-built framework. And yes, there are a lot of internal tools that are being built. Yes, on the outside, there are not many that we could look at. Probably they may change. I don't know. I may not even have the right answer for that right now.
Thank you.
But DoubleClick happens to be one of the biggest customers. There were a couple of sites, I think. If you probably go, so there's a site which says built with Angular and built with Angular 2. There are quite a few sites on there. I think some parts of even YouTube are on Angular, if I'm not
mistaken.
Some
parts of YouTube, but none of the sites are completely.
You need to realize that YouTube was an acquisition by somebody else. They had built on a different framework, and trying to migrate such large applications is going to take a lot of time and effort and consensus, right? And the way Google, I think, works is everybody, his own individual team, you need to sell. You need to sell a lot internally within Google. Again, I may not be the right person to comment on these things. You should probably ask the Googleizers to get the booth out there.
Thank you.
Hello, hi. Sudarshan here.
Yeah.
So I want to just ask a couple of questions. One about AOT that you were talking about.
Yeah.
Do we need to do anything specifically during bundling to enable AOT, irrespective of the bundling mechanism we use, whether you use Webpack, Gulp, or anything like that? So how is it like?
It depends what your tool stack is. If you're using the Angular CLI, everything is very, very seamlessly built in. So if you're using Angular CLI, for example, you do an ng serve, it will run the application in dev mode. You do an ng build, or you do an lg build --prod, it will automatically run it in, it will run using the ngc compiler, convert it to AOT, do the bundling, and give it out. So that's the ultimate aim that it is going to reach out. So the Angular CLI will become the single go-to tool for all your solutions. As of now, if you really want to do that, yes, you'll have to use, you can use Webpack, you can use System.js, you can use any of your bundling tools. It's just the NGC compiler that you need to run. It's just only single thing, yeah.
Okay, so one more question is like, see, nowadays a lot of frameworks have come. We have
Correct.
React.js, we have Vue.js. If in a big organization, it is quite possible each team has their own set of frameworks.
Exactly,
running
yeah.
On. So I would like to know, like, I understand that Angular is inspired from web components. So if we develop any component or any widget on Angular.js, would it be interportable in terms of other MVC frameworks?
So that is the aim, or you know, that I would call that as the final destination for how web components should evolve onto. So you have components, and the components can be built using different frameworks, and they're all interoperable. As of now, it's not as easy as it should be. But if you probably look at AOT, the next step for AOT would be, so right now AOT compiles it into VM-friendly code, but it is still specific to Angular in some extent. If you're able to take it to the next state where it's just pure JavaScript and all the other frameworks do that, then I can get a component that is agnostic to any framework. Because end of the day, it's just talking to HTML, CSS, and pure JavaScript. So I think that's the next stage when what you're saying should be possible. As of now, I think it's still bundled. It's with every other framework as of yet. It's the same with React, it's the same with Polymer, other things. So Polymer and Angular are working a lot closer to try and make sure the interoperability between them is a lot more smoother. But as of yet, I think every framework has that situation where they want to, there's a bit of a dependency on the framework. But I think the next evolution of frameworks is probably going to be where every framework renders it to pure JavaScript. And web components becomes the holy grail.
Yeah. Hi. Here.
I'm sorry, I can't see you.
No, here.
Okay, yeah.
Okay, so first of all, I would like to say a nice presentation and a lot of good pointers.
Thank you.
But I have few questions regarding, so basically, it's about building a mobile app, mm-hmm. right? A cross-platform app.
Okay.
So if one comes to choose between React Native,
right,
and an Angular 2, pure Angular 2 app,
okay.
right? So I know that Ionic has support for Angular 2 and it had support for Angular 1 as well.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's kind of debatable, like what will you choose over Ionic with Angular 2 or React Native where Facebook has huge amount of support, right?
Yeah. So there's a slight difference, I would say, between the way Ionic works and Angular React Native works. So React Native uses native APIs, whereas Ionic is still using Angular and is using something like Cordova to do a hybrid app, right? But what you should instead look at is something called TypeScript. So TypeScript is working very closely with Angular 2 to build native front-end UIs with Angular. So you can look at TypeScript. The TypeScript will become an exact competitor to React Native in a certain way.
So and Ionic 2 is using TypeScript only, right?
So sorry, did I say TypeScript?
Ionic?
No. Native script, I'm so sorry. Native script. So native script is the native script is a framework by Telerik where it renders into front complete UI. I'm sorry, I completely used the wrong word. Yeah. Native script. So native script
okay.
to compare.
So native script is using it's a direct competitor to React Native. That's
yes,
what you're saying.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. That answers my question.
Hi Vinci, this is Abhijit. I think you are the first one to mention TypeScript in the conference for the last 2 days. I mean, what do you see with the evolution of ES6 and ES7? Is TypeScript going to? I mean, it's just an opinion-related question, I believe.
Sure.
Do you think that TypeScript is going to survive long, or should we stay together with plain JavaScript?
I'm not sure. How do you want to? So your question is, will TypeScript become obsolete?
I mean, the question is, TypeScript brings a lot of goodies like interface,
yeah.
class, and polymorphism.
Yeah.
All those things
yeah.
are there
yeah.
in JavaScript, but with function keyword.
Yes.
When it comes to ES6 and ES7, they have inherently started supporting all those things in a better way. So is it like TypeScript still makes sense when writing Angular 2 apps?
I would say for Angular 2, definitely yes, because there's a lot of tight integrations with that. But even to answer the general question on TypeScript, what I personally feel is somehow browsers are always going to be lagging behind in terms of the innovation that's going to happen in JavaScript, right? And you're always going to be dependent on polyfills in a certain way. So you're either going to be using Babel or something else to keep compiling. And if TypeScript is allowing you to do that, plus a lot more, and plus help you improve productivity, I think it's taking care of everything. So I do not think TypeScript should go obsolete, because things will keep moving forward. Yeah.
Refactoring is easy.
Thank you, Vinci.
Thank you.